All the functional groups in this video contain a carbon-oxygen double bond. And we call a carbon-oxygen double bond a carbonyl. So here you can see a carbon-oxygen double bond in this functional group, and here's another one in this functional group, and here's another one down here. For the first functional group, this is called an aldehyde. So an aldehyde has an R group on one side of the carbonyl and a hydrogen on the other side of the carbonyl. As an example, let's look at this compound. So here is our carbonyl, our carbon-oxygen double bond. And then on this side, we have a hydrogen directly bonded to this carbonyl carbon. On the left side, we have this R group. So the carbonyl carbon gets a number 1. It gets the lowest number possible. And then this carbon would get a number 2, this carbon would get a number 3, and this carbon would get a number 4. So we have a 4-carbon aldehyde. So how do we name a 4-carbon aldehyde? Well, a 4-carbon alkane we know is butane. So 1, 2, 3, and 4, we know that this compound is called butane. An aldehyde has an AL ending. So if you see an AL ending, that indicates the presence of an aldehyde. So we're going to lose the E from butane and add on AL. So the name of this molecule becomes butanal. So let me write that out here. So this is butanal. Next, let's look at a ketone. So a ketone has an R group on one side of the carbonyl and an R group on the other side of the carbonyl. So for our ketone example, let's look at this compound. We're going to number to give our carbonyl the lowest number possible. So we're going to start numbering from the left side of our compound. So this would get carbon number 1. The carbonyl carbon would be carbon number 2. This is carbon number 3. This is carbon number 4. And this is carbon number 5. So we have a 5-carbon ketone. A 5-carbon alkane, let me go ahead and draw out a 5-carbon alkane here. This would be called pentane. So that would be pentane. A ketone has an O-N-E ending. So own indicates the presence of a ketone. So we're going to lose the E from pentane and add own. So this would be pentanone. So this is pentanone. We also need to indicate the position of the carbonyl. So the carbonyl is at carbon 2. So we need to write 2-pentanone. And that's because we could draw another molecule that's pentanone, but this could have the carbonyl at carbon 3. So let me go ahead and write that in here. 1, 2, 3. So this compound would be 3-pentanone. And 3-pentanone and 2-pentanone are different molecules. So that's why we need to indicate the position of the carbonyl. For the aldehyde up here, we didn't need to indicate that the aldehyde is at carbon 1. That's the only place that it could possibly be. Notice that an aldehyde has this hydrogen, right, directly bonded to the carbonyl carbon, whereas a ketone has, if we look at the carbonyl group right here, we have a carbon on one side, right, a CH3 on one side in this case, and we have a carbon on this side directly bonded to that carbonyl carbon. So that's the difference between an aldehyde and a ketone, and a lot of students have a hard time telling the difference between an aldehyde and a ketone. Look for this hydrogen directly bonded to the carbonyl carbon, and that's an aldehyde. Next, we have a carboxylic acid. So a carboxylic acid has an R group on one side of the carbonyl and an OH on the other side. Some students think that this is an alcohol at first, but this is not an alcohol. This OH is right next to this carbonyl, and that changes the properties. Carboxylic acids have different properties from alcohols. So for an example of a carboxylic acid, over here on the right, we know that our carbonyl carbon gets number 1, so that's carbon number 1. This is carbon number 2, carbon number 3, and carbon number 4. So a 4-carbon carboxylic acid. So a 4-carbon alkane up here was butane. So we're going to have oic acid as our ending. So it would be butanoic acid for the name for this compound. So this is just one of the names. So one of the names for this molecule would be butanoic acid. All right. Probably the most famous carboxylic acid is a 2-carbon carboxylic acid. So I can just draw it like this really quickly. And this is called acetic acid. So vinegar is just a dilute solution of acetic acid in water. All right, our next functional group. It's called an acyl halide, or we could also call it an acid halide. And you're pretty much talking about acid chlorides in organic chemistry. And so here is our carbon-oxygen double bond. And then on this side, we have an R group. And the right side, we have a chlorine. So acyl halides come from carboxylic acid. So this is an example of a carboxylic acid derivative. And an example of an acyl halide on the right here, we have our carbonyl, and then we have our halogen. And the reason I like to call it an acyl halide is this right here on the left, this is an acyl group, and on the right we have our halogen. So this would be acetyl chloride is one of the names for this, but you could also call them an acid halide. These are carboxylic acid derivatives. So some professors prefer one term, and some professors prefer the other term. Our next functional group is an acid anhydride. So here is our carbonyl, here's the R group, and instead of a chlorine like we had up here, we have all of this over here on the right. So this is an acid anhydride, or just an anhydride. This is also a carboxylic acid derivative. You can form an acid anhydride from a carboxylic acid. And for the example over here on the right, we have acetic anhydride. Next functional group is called an ester. So an ester is another carboxylic acid derivative. So a carboxylic acid had a hydrogen in this position, but now we have an R group. So we have our carbonyl, we have an OR, and then we have an R on the left. So that's an ester. And here's an example of an ester over here. So we have an ethyl group instead of a hydrogen. So for acetic acid, let me go ahead and draw acetic acid again. Acetic acid had a hydrogen right here, and now we have an ethyl group. So instantly we know we're talking about an ester. We're not talking about a carboxylic acid. If you wanted to name this ester, you have this ethyl group, so that would be ethyl, and then this part would be acetate. So ethyl acetate would be the name. Now for the names of all of these, you're going to get to them later in the course, so it's probably not that important to name these compounds, but it's good to start hearing these things now. And finally, our last functional group is called an amide. At least that's what I call it, but there are several different ways to pronounce this functional group. The dictionary says, at least my dictionary says, amide or amide are the two preferred ways to pronounce this. You'll probably hear amide as one of the most common ways to pronounce this. A lot of professors say amide, and some professors get pretty upset if you don't pronounce this the way that they want. I've heard many more ways to pronounce this functional group too, like amide and all kinds of things. Use whatever pronunciation your professor wants. That's always the way to do things. Now we have a carbonyl. All right, notice we have a nitrogen right next to the carbonyl carbon. So a nitrogen directly bonded to the carbonyl carbon, lone pair of electrons on the nitrogen. So that's an amide functional group, or an amide functional group. So these R's could be hydrogens, right? You could be talking about hydrogens, or you could be talking about alkyl groups. So there's lots of different examples of amides or amides. On the right is an example. So our carbonyl carbon gets a number 1. So this would be 1, this would be number 2, this would be number 3, this would be a number 4. So a 4 carbon amide would be butanamide. So let me go ahead and write that down here. So this would be butanamide or butanamide, depending on how you prefer to pronounce this functional group.